you already said this was in no way a planned provocation, but it's a good excuse to start with a reflection on why do I, after the well-known fiasco, which needs no comment, why do I still, in some sense, I will try to explain in what sense, consider myself a communist. First, we are also celebrating, as you know, these days, we are a little bit late, the 20 years of the fall of the Berlin Wall. Of course, it was a good thing that it fell. What we should ask ourselves is, what does that mean? Is the struggle over? Did we, as Fukuyama thought, at least he thought this in the 90s, now he changed his opinion, did we discover, if not the best possible world, then at least the least bad world of liberal capitalist democracy? That is to say, what I want to say is this. When I was young, I remember many of my friends were dreaming about so-called socialism with a human face. It's interesting how, incidentally, already here, they concede that it's only the face, you know, that behind it's a monster, but it's trying to put it a human face. I claim that a large majority, even the moderate leftists, still dream today basically on global capitalism with a human face. That is to say, let's make it a little bit more tolerant, ecologically oriented, helping the poor in developing countries, anti-racist, and so on and so on. But the forum is here. Is this enough? The problem is, I claim, and I will try to explain why, is it is not enough. We are witnessing today what? You know, one of the titles of late Freud's short books, studies, is Unbehagen in der Kultur, the discontent, uneasiness in culture. We are today living in an era which can be designated as Unbehagen in liberalism, uneasiness with liberalism. And I wouldn't be too glad about it, like, because it's not as some too naive leftist think, fine, financial crisis, that's it, we will soon take over. Crisis is just a brute, stupid fact of a crisis. The problem is who and how will interpret the crisis. To put it in Lacanian jargon, how it will be symbolized. You know, nothing is self-evident. Take France in 1939, the fiasco of instant almost defeat, being defeated by Germany, and for the first 2-3 years, remember, De Gaulle was a tiny minority. The story of Marshal Petain won, which was, no, it's not our weakness compared to Germany, it's our innermost decadence. We were too liberal under the Jewish influence and so on and so on. So Petain's formula was, we should even thank the Germans for awakening us from this liberal, degenerate, permissive stupor to reconstruct the proper authoritarian state, or, as Petain once put it, to correct the mistake which was the French Revolution. So I wouldn't have too many hopes about crisis. If we look at the ongoing financial crisis, I claim that its main effect will rather be something that for designated by Naomi Klein, the title of her book, you know, as shock therapy. I mean, you know, shock therapies can work in a strange way. I claim that if we read even, paradoxically, many old Maoists hate me for saying this, but retroactively we can today state that the big cultural revolution was a shock therapy for capitalism. Of course, Mao didn't want this, but you know, the formula was rebel, be free, get rid of all tradition. It was a gesture of, as it were, clearing the table, and then people found themselves at the end in the void. Up then Deng Xiaoping comes capitalism. And why do I mention China? Because China is perhaps the main lesson that the situation is not as simple as it may appear. What is going on today in China? Recently I spoke with my relative friend, politically definitely not, but personally in very good terms, Peter Sloterdijk, the German, who told me a very interesting thing, that he recently tried to imagine